that I am extremely pleased, very pleased, that my first visit to India is to honor Charles Correa at his Goa Foundation. For Charles Correa, I have a twofold feeling. On the one hand, it is the respect felt for his remarkable contributions to our profession, and to the other, it is that of an old and profound friendship. Charles Correa works, responds to the most relevant issues of our profession in the transition from the 20th to the 21st century. Educated as an architect, first in his country and later in America, he was close to some of the protagonists of modernism, such as Buckminster Fuller and Minoru Yamasaki, and he promptly realized that even when conceived with the same principles, buildings should be different. When talking about one of his most celebrated recent works, the Champalimo Center in Lisbon, I quote in this very special occasion what he has said, and I quote, "A musician can play the same Chopin concert one evening in Tokyo and then the next in Brazil and the third in Paris with every note exactly the same, but not the architect, for a building is rooted in the soil on which it stands, in the climate, in the technology, in the culture, and in the aspirations of the society that uses it. This is why the same building cannot be repeated anywhere and everywhere in the world." I believe, and I finish the quote, I believe that such a statement reflects something that Charles Correa has maintained in his work throughout his fertile and productive life as an architect. He has never ignored that whenever his work was required, whatever he built, his professional answer would be respectful to the place it was located and useful to the society to which it is destined. And it has been in service to such principles that Charles Correa conceives his architecture. By serving specific people in specific places, he has reached the attention and the respect of his colleagues all over the world. In recognizing always that buildings are built for people, he has given his work a sense of reality that distinguishes it from the flat idealism of an architecture that relies only on the discipline itself, distancing his work from the narcissism close to the work of so many architects. And after having said that, you will appreciate how pleased I am to be here tonight with Charles Correa, with the opportunity of honoring him in his own country. Indeed, I am grateful to begin my trip to India with this chance to celebrate Charles Correa's career. Thank you, Charles, for the gifts that you have made to architects in these difficult days for the profession, with your always remarkable and admirable work. I would like, and I finish, and telling Charles how thankful I am to him for just bringing me and giving me this opportunity tonight and making this presentation. And I would like with this presentation to cover a double target. In the first, I would like to show you, show to my Indian colleagues some of my work. But on the other hand, I very much would like to do some contribution and say something about what the conference would like to be the issue and the heart of it, and therefore related to the city. I have chosen just the way, not just on the middle, but the way where both intentions coincide, and it will be to present the work that I have done, only the work that I have done in the city where I have lived that is Madrid. My work in Madrid then for approaching, serving as a frame, background for projecting what to the issue that I would like to raise, that is how architects should react in these days of globalization towards the idea of the generic city. Aldo Rossi's notion about how cities are characterized by architecture, presented in his book, The Architecture of the City, is today probably diffused and accepted. It emphasizes how cities reflect its identity throughout architecture. And yet, I would like to say, with a slight nuance, that we should add to his proposal another one that claims the role played by the architects of the city. I would like to remind you something that you probably are quite aware of, and is the fact how in cities you are able to identify the work of architects behind them. Behind architecture, they were architects able to be so embedded and so permeating so much the cities themselves, that you can't see cities without seeing who were the architects behind. Obviously, that is more noticeable in newer cities than in the old ones. We are able to recognize the architects' contribution in cities such as the London of Christopher Wren and Nash, the Berlin of Schinkel, the Vienna of Otto Wagner and the Secessionists, the Barcelona of Gaudí and the Modernists, the Madrid and Villanueva, and I would say that almost every city can be associated with architects, and their architecture has behind architects, and they play a role in the growing of the city that made architects so substantial as what they do, the architecture itself. We clearly identify these architects in the definition of the character of all these cities. For that reason, architects offer the key for our understanding of cities. The work, the life of the architect is something deeply rooted in the city. To illustrate this association between architects and the cities in which they live and work, I will refer to my own work, a series of projects along the Castellana Boulevard in Madrid, Bank Inter, Bank of Spain, the Thyssen-Bornemisza Museum, the extension of the Prado Museum, and the Atocha Railway Station, show how a professional career became embedded in the city fabric that has been my home. Behind cities, there are the specific architects. You are able to distinguish architects in cities and to identify them, architects who are ultimately responsible of the cities themselves. But naturally, an obvious observation like this one brings us to think that it isn't so easy for the work of architects today to configure the city. There is undoubtedly a question of scale, seen in the big cities. In the metropolis, the work of an individual dissolves in the vast ocean of what is built. It means that the size of the cities probably favored what the thesis of what I said, that the cities that architects could share, or architects could work in favor of one identity of the city which they serve. But the huge the scale of big cities probably doesn't that's so easy to take this attempt. There is undoubtedly a question of scale, since in the big cities, in the metropolis, the work of an individual dissolves in the vast ocean of what is built. But above all, it would be useful to emphasize how much globalization has led us to understand the world of us if it were just one big city. There is a moment when one believes, or one is tending to think about, the city is gone in a way. The city is the entire world, you don't anymore are able to identify the cities the way we use. This is the most serious question you are able to do. And that is the issue that I would like to put on the table for the discussion, as much as I will use my own word to see how I believe architects still have a chance to be identified with their own cities. Should we think that the city as we knew it will disappear, giving rise to a generic city regardless of size of scale? Should we simply accept that attributes such as identity and character, which we use to speak of a city, won't be possible now that architects rarely work consistently in a particular city? Cities, architects seems that they are not any more committed with their cities as much as we work everywhere. If it is their way of being that permitted us to name cities and distinguish their distinctive qualities, if we are able to give a name to each city, should we demand of the itinerant architect that they identify the peculiarities of the city where they build? Should we ask, in those days of globalization, architects still to keep in mind where they work? Should the architect feel bound to that which characterizes the city where he lives, and with such convictions confront the difficulty that working in other cities implies? Should we just work with the tools of what we know in our own cities and then translate that directly in other places' experience? Or rather, do those institutions which make foreign architects commission envisioning that they will build in a city a work of quality, and that work will be an example of their talent, everything with risks, no doubt about it, but should forget the place where they are? When an institution is asking an architect to do something in another city, is just keeping in mind that they will do something good, or should they forget in the city where they are, just buying an architecture or piece of architecture that works as a good, or should the architect be truly committed with the city, then making something that is not only his or her work, but also something that belongs to the city? I think that there are, without doubt, unsettling and crucial questions that don't have easy answers. The reflection, I leave that in the reflection to the audience, but I should finish with this introduction, saying that nothing more favorable or desirable than practicing in one's own city, where the common ground is none other than the well-known frame of our daily lives. And I would like just thought this statement that could be seen as the reflection about the problem that seems to be are present in everybody practice. I would like now to pass to show some of my work in this continuous frame of my own city, Madrid. And I think that I will start to tell you something about Madrid. And the first thing would be, probably you are aware that Madrid was chosen as Spain capital just so late as 1553, and it was Philip II in the days when Spain as a kingdom had a presence in so many places in the world. He needed to make the choice of where to place the capital. Since then, the Spanish court crown didn't have court. It was moving from one city to another. And then surely that Philip II could be tempted. And you have seen the map that just showed you. He could be, let's say, placed the capital in Seville, that was facing the other side of the Atlantic in America, or could have thought about Lisbon as well, because in those days Spain was associated with Portugal as much as Philip II was the son of Isabel of Portugal, married with Charles V, or could have been Barcelona, watching into the Mediterranean interest that the Spanish kingdom has, or could have been one of those cities in the center of Spain, the most, let's say, the most central, could be said, Toledo, that was also the capital of the very early kingdom of Spain before the Islamic entrance in Spain. Or some others of those cities in the Castilian in the Castilian region, like Ávila or Segovia or Medina del Campo. But then he has chosen. Nothing very important, but just to remind you, Toledo was there and Madrid was there. That is a very intriguing map. It's a map of communications in Spain in 1546. And then you look at that, Toledo was there, and the king has chosen just there, 50 kilometers away from Madrid, in this, very much thinking that perhaps news and communication could happen from this central condition in the shorter way. And that was the reason why Madrid was chosen, perhaps also for political reasons, to be quite out of the influence that cities had, cities like Ávila or Segovia, the role they have played in some fight with his father's arrival to Spain. Anyway, in any case, he has chosen this small city in the middle of Spain that was quite well communicated, if you want, but that was a small village of no more than 4,000 inhabitants with a small river running south and with a small castle in one of the one of the borders. And at the end of the 15th century, the city was like that. Just this medieval city has been standing on, just looking for as a very normal rural cities, looking for the ways and the roads bringing to other cities. And then when the king decided that Madrid will be the capital, very promptly goes and comes into another valley. It can be seen that the population lives between these two valleys and reaches this border of another valley that runs there, and this is La Castellana that has been since then, let's say, the one of the main arteries, the true, let's say, the key the structure of the road system of the city. And that is the way it ended in at the end of the 17th century, when the dynasty changes and goes in the hands of the Bourbons of France. The city has reached, as you are saying, this other valley, this valley that runs north-south, and that is La Castellana, that is still, that since then has become, as I said, the true structure of the city, and where I will show you the work that we are going to see tonight. And this is the best known map of Madrid, the middle of 17th century, the days of Velázquez, just to find out exactly what I'm trying to say. And still that you would be able to distinguish two of the major ways that the castle was there. It has rebuilt almost like a much more presentable palace, and then another palace has been built in the other side of La Castellana. It was a palace that mixed with a convent, a monastery, and then the ways, the roads, the streets coinciding with roads leaving, as I said, to the other cities. And you have here, when the Bourbons arrived, they found this very clear border and decided to use this border just as the alignment for all those new institutions that came with the Bourbon. Those institutions being hospitals, and then the mint, and then the nobility, which came here to put also their palaces and houses, and then that will be used later on in 19th century as just this axis where most of the public institutions were going to find its place. Here you see the map of Madrid in 1848, where you see consolidated La Castellana, and then later that very rapidly 1868, when the Madrid does a plan of extension, taking La Castellana as this axis and makes something like Cartesian extension in the way as Barcelona did with Cerdà. But you are able to identify here the role played by this artery that is reinforced by the fact that the first railway station was going to be placed there. And here we are, that is the true map, because the other is just the project of extension that didn't go on so rapidly, but that is what happened in the end of 19th century. And I want to call to your attention that the curious thing about that is that this road had been hindered by the fact that the horses racecourse has been built there, and then the potential of the street to go on wouldn't happen, and then the road of just becoming a public promenade was reinforced. You see the extension that I was talking about that started to be filled up, and then just to remind you that in 1929, a very well-known international competition for Madrid extension took out the horses racecourse and gave the La Castellana the ability to, to conduct the growing of Madrid. Since then, that is where, since then, it has been indeed the most important, I would say that almost the street in Madrid, not only the artery, and the world we are going to see, as I said, I have had the fortune of making some of my work here, and we are going to see all those buildings, Bankinter, some intervention in the back of Spain, Thyssen-Bornemisza, the extension of the Prado, and the extension of railway station. And that will be a way of just presenting to my Indian colleagues something of my work as an architect. But I thought it would be better to keep that connected with the city and allowing to speak about the cities that just starting in a more chronological way. We will, you see that, and you are able to identify this Madrid Park, that is the Retiro, what remains of what was the property of the second palace. Madrid, the kings built this second palace that I mentioned to you, that happened to be there, and then what remained of the property was transformed in this part that very much structured the city nowadays. Here you see that we will see Bankinter there, then the Bank of Spain over there, then the Thyssen-Bornemisza there, then the Prado there, and then the railway station over there. That is the first one. That was the very first work that I did in Madrid. It was 1972 when I received this commission. And it should be said that that was the very first intervention in those years that instead of just turning down those small palaces of the nobility, tried to keep that and put something close by that was able to both keep what is still, or I indeed believe that has value with something else. And then I paid attention to the issue of just being close by using the same material, mostly brick, and then just trying to emphasize all the contingencies that are given to the geometry in this building such an importance, or just passing probably those contingencies could be seen, this freedom in handling the building that came from what we have started to learn from Venturi, and then later I would say that you would be able to find down in this this importance to be given to the single element that has the window, the influence of an architect from whom I learned so much as Aldo Rossi. Probably the Rossian experience is there as much as we are still valuing interiors and thinking that the architecture always has this commitment between inside and outside that does quite difficult, if possible, to establish differences between inside and outside when talking about architecture. And then the building keeps this sense of, it becomes something like a background of the existing palace that sometimes recovers what the street used to be by respecting what has been built before. I would say that in those days where brutalism prevailed, there's a certain, let's say, pleasure in giving materials the right touch, what was something that I see with a certain respect when I go back to see Bankinter. Now we are going to see the extension of the Bank of Spain that happens to be there. At that, and again, if the other would allow me or has allowed to me to speak about the interests of architects in those days, I would say that this is much more problematic under many means, because raises issues about which is the true nature of architecture and about what architecture as a body of knowledge is allowing architects to do. Here is the Bank of Spain, the very respectful building, the building that has something to do with, let's say, the British institutional buildings, as well as with the, let's say, the French academicism, but the very solid building built in the heart of Madrid, and that has a very definitive presence in the image of the city, in what people and how people perceive what the city is. And then this building went through many extensions. I'm sorry, but I don't to enter into some detail on that, because otherwise we wouldn't understand what I try to do. If you look at the, first image there, this is a building on La Castellana. The building tries to make a facade also on this main plaza, and then establishes this, let's say, conventional way of dealing with two wings building with the main stair over there. And it was extended in 1929, and in 29 the building is losing this vocation of just being only in La Castellana, and takes also a stand, a very important stand on this other street. In the 70s it was extended this way, and at the end it remained only this corner. And the issue was, it was the competition, very intriguing competition in 1978, as I said, and it was how to do with this small corner. Should it be built with the modern piece of architecture, or should be done something else? In this case, my answer, that was polemic and that instead still could be considered as such, was that the corner was so small in relationship with what it meant, the entire block, that it would be better to do something that, recognizing the way the building has grown, was able to solve the problem there. And then the issue was to follow what the architects did in trying to turn and to make the corner there. And that was the building that was going to be turned down. We cut it by that because it was required by the width of the street. And I came with this solution that somehow, and the worth, if some worth has this project, is the fact that it includes in all this corner this existing piece. This piece that was moved and made almost as a replica that was below, by giving it a certain presence in the corner as a whole, make the intervention that was even shorter than the building itself, make the intervention a bit more important. And then, clearly, the building, the competition that was won, as I said, in 1978, slept for 25 years, and 25 years later, I was asked in the 2005 to go on, or 2003 to go on with this project. It became much more complex. If in the competition it was just saying how to react to the main facade, in this moment I would say that the project started to be, I was older, and I would say that it's much more sensitive to all the geometry of the judgment that requires this way of turning around with the facade, and that, and then by raising the issue of what is a building, if the building can be built exactly as it was, would be able to retain the nature of the building by remaking it. Well, you know that the Japanese temple has been so many times remade, and it isn't exactly the same case, because in this case we wanted also, and we are not just replicating precisely and exactly all the moldings, but at the end we oversimplify almost with this convention of just missing the naturalistic way of molding and sculptures in something that at the end is embedded in this mass that, that indeed makes the way the intervention has happened almost imperceptible. That means that as the restorers of painting they often did, or they often have done, I am trying to make the intervention, leaving quite clearly hints of what we did and where the new construction has been, as I said, oversimplified as the head on the round molding shores. Again, one other project that still, no, curiously, and I am, even though it belongs to the conclusion, I would say that I am happy to have worked in La Castellana most of the times just revamping, or just giving buildings a new meaning and a new way of being used. I would like it to happen respecting what I consider to be more important, that obviously it would be the role and the character that La Castellana as a whole plays in the city. But here we need to enter in the detail again, and sorry, but otherwise it wouldn't make sense to bring it here. Here is a painting of late 17th century where you see La Castellana when it was the promenade, this promenade, and where we are going to work on is just in this corner, where the building was built. And here we are there. This is the street that brings people from the palace, the royal palace, to the second royal palace that was here, and that was burnt out and destroyed by a fire in 1723. But then this palace that was built by the Duke of Villahermosa started here in the street, in this corner, and it was going on steadily throughout 50 years till 1835, when it was extended and reached into this newly bought property that gave to this facade preeminence above the other. In the meanwhile, as I said, this attain, a bit that has happened with the Bank of Spain, the central stair has given up into the new facade, the new entrance from there. The building belongs, it matches again the subject of the court of my intervention. The building is the result, is the work of an architect who was a pupil of Villanueva, the architect that we are going to see again in the Prado Museum. And he's very, very respectful with the construction. It mixes brick and stone in the most wise way. Every element and every piece can be considered as the highest rationality by somebody who indeed knew pretty well what to build the building meant. And then I would say that it was very much sudden when in the 70s the building was completely voided, and it was completely voided by the bank, who turned down entirely all what the building was but the facade. And then the entrance that with the Dukes happened to be in this extended and enlarged facade went again into this Carrera de San Jerónimo, the street that brings into the palace. That is what the building was in 1970s. And then when I was asked to do something here, that you should consider that was just an academic exercise, saying what you will do for a museum that has been kept, the facade, and would be filled up with the collection. And that was the token that the Spanish government used with with the Baron Thyssen-Bornemisza to get the collection came to Spain. And then imagine if the building has started from the other facade and ended up with that. And then in this case, nothing happened inside. It was void, as I said. How you will redo the structure of that? Just considering that that was going to be a museum. And then we ended, we put the entrance here. We made this big courtyard that allowed us to establish the stair and allowed us to move around as the museum was looking for. We kept, let's say, strictly all windows and openings and so the structuring the new system of walls in a way that would allow it to go through this sense of frontality that gives to all this conventional collection of, let's say, Western paintings, this way of facing and finding frontally. And that is what we did. And then now the building appears here exactly as it was, with the new skylights and with the new wing that happened to be just in the Mitoyan wall connected with the neighbor, and that was used by office. But I would say that in this case, I would like to see this project almost out of whatever kind of personalism. I am here very much thinking that an architect could be called to do something like that, and then trying to make it just with what the knowledge, and again it's a word that I ought to use here, the knowledge allowed you to do. And now we are going to enter in the two projects to come. It can be said that doesn't belong to the same family. But obviously here is much more complex. If the other, the building was clearly defined, here it will happen almost the opposite. Here it was a way of relocating and then giving to the existing museum a new way once that a new piece of land has been added. That was also the competition, and then I probably ought to explain you something even from this image, because the Prado was is an extraordinary building built at the end of 18th century, and I consider, and I wouldn't like to be just by the being the Spanish, but I would say that is the most brilliant building of Europe in the end of the 18th century. And it's a building that has the architect tried to put together two academies. One academy that was the botanist that came from the botanical garden and moved longitudinally from there into this way, and another that were people related with chemistry and physics. Here doesn't happen to be this hall and this plaza, and instead the slope of the land came and allowed to enter from there, and you move in the other direction. That means that two longitudinal buildings were opposed, one moving this way, the other moving the other way. And both academies met, supposedly to meet, in this apsid-like space there, where with the balcony allowed to keep the same hierarchy to both academies. The building is deceptive, because when you mark here, and the building with the main facade of the Prado always seems to be almost a conventional axial building, and instead, as I said, has this inner and hidden energy with these two encountered and opposed movement. But then later, all the tensions in the Prado, and that this image that comes from the old plan that I showed you shows you where the old monastery was and how the palace was just attached to the monastery with this system of big courts. The building of Thyssen Bornemisza was in this corner. We are in 1650 here, and then the monastery fell down completely, and then the issue was all the extension of the Prado has happened behind, and yet losing this sense of this door. And what we tried to do was just to connect the give to this entrance the new, let's say, axis or new system of movement that brings you into the new the given land to the Prado that was there around an existing courtyard. The only thing that remained from the museum and that we have seen here, that was what remained of the courtyard. And as I said, all the distinctions of the Prado happened to be adding new and new base behind it and maintaining this entrance. Instead, as I said, the entrance, one of the main entrances happened to be here. And by trying to recover a transversal axis instead of this longitudinal axis, we are allowed to colonize all the room and the space and the surfaces gained around the court, around the existing courtyard of the monastery. And then the Prado extension well clearly shows these two systems of alignment, the alignment that is created by La Castellana and the alignment that was created by the old museum that is there. Both are creating this interstitial space that is used as an entrance and that helps people to go into what has been given room in the new extensions that are mostly mid auditorium and space for temporary rooms and then the cafeteria and then shop and then the connection with the building that works and offices and so on. And then this is an image of this interstitial space that allow that I would like allow it people to have always the sense and the presence of the existing building. And then what has happened with the apsid-like space where the two academies should meet, that is an extension of this entrance from the main hall. And then later the way the going from under this platform garden, you reach into all the construction around the existing courtyard that dates from the end of the 17th century. The building, indeed, that is the doors by the artist Cristina Iglesias, very beautiful doors that have became quite a very important element embedded in the architecture. And then I would like to, let's say, reach to your consideration how this intervention, instead of being seen as just working in a single building, tries to give the building this sense of not ending, being moving a piece in the check in the in the in came, moving some piece means that you need to reconsider almost everything. The building doesn't end in itself. The building is an object. Instead, the building should be seen just when considering the city as a whole, as something that doesn't have clear borders. And instead, you like what I would like to think about working in a piece of the city, much more than just thinking of seeing the intervention reduced to the presence of the building itself. Here you are seeing the space between the two buildings that has become a new access to the building. Obviously, one could keep in mind what happens with the Louvre, where you entered under the pyramid. Here you entered under the platform, landscape platform, that can be said that recovered the slope that went down from these levels where the old palace was built into La Castellana. Now we are coming to the last and largest and perhaps most structurally speaking important intervention, that is this intervention in Atocha, that was also the competition. That means that three of the five projects on La Castellana has the result of competition. That was to add something to this clear 19th century structure of the railway. Here is showing how and we have seen some of the plans reflected the way this the first railway station was established, how the railway station grows in the end of 19th century, and how we needed to grow up. And that was already my intervention, when you needed to enlarge from 6 to 12 platforms here, and then to be connected with the local trains that went below this level, and yet making the due connections between the local railway station and the long distance railway station that is the Atocha. And then here, what we did, we didn't try to in this competition to replicate what, and there were some other competitors making balls. Instead, I tried to underline the value of those horizontal levels and horizontality for making easy all the connections among the people. And then another second extension happened when the new train of high speed arrived to Madrid and was needed to duplicate the capacity of the platforms, and therefore providing two ways of entering and going out because of the length of the trains. And here something that will happen later when the new parking garage could be built here, but that, and the new railway station will happen here, connecting the two railway Madrid stations, Atocha and San Martin. And here the drawing from the competition. We are 1984 with this hypostyle hall that somehow speaks of this lack of directionality that indeed enhances the value of the people's mobility against the pleasure in just enjoying the common vault of space. Here, quite a compelling image of the construction. You see the local railway station, the buses running around, the underground that comes this way, all that connected under these platforms, and that does also that allowed to change the direction of the station, because you are not entering from here, entering from there, so making the railway station something like an inner garden. The third railway station will come close beside and attached to this other street when the tunnel connecting Atocha and Chamartín will be built. Here the lantern running around the buses, some images of the most recent intervention that are here. That here, that the access, and here again the Castellana as a whole. That is, let's say, what I use to give you some information about my work, my personal work as an architect. But right to this point, what I will say about the future of the cities, or how I see cities, if something relates of this project is what I would like to call a certain sense of continuity. Perhaps but the very first project, the Bankinter project, where it can be said that there are other issues, not only continuity, and even continuity if you consider to keep and to maintain the alive, the small palace attached to which I put the building. All the other buildings are indeed just trying to extend the life of some buildings that with the help of what I could say about how to deal with the issue of just making the corner in the back of Spain or remaking entirely the inner the space in Thyssen-Bornemisza or allowing to the Prado again to improve the access and to be read and seen and perceived and much more connected with the old palace and the old monastery that just and so enlarging and extending all the way with the building as Atocha, where indeed for such an important infrastructural speaking piece of architecture to contribute to make it more active and efficient was crucial and was a genuine architectural problem, where it's not only about images and sometimes imagery and just the symbolic value of architecture is quite crucial, but wasn't exactly that the case. And yet, I would say that try don't to disrupt, don't be in the city in a way that you find out how it grows and moves on time. It seems to me quite an attractive city to work and to be in the city. What means just resist, I wouldn't say reject, or more clearly, difficult to say that cities don't have themselves and almost all of them something that characterized and that pursued the way that they had been on time, gives architects the hint to do their work without betraying what the cities allow them to be named. That gives to me, let's say, an interest in working the city that goes farther away above the generic city. It could happen cities being built at once nowadays, but that is another completely different issue that just thinking that once you are working in a city, you shouldn't consider what the city was. I think that I consider a pleasure and a gift to work in a single city and to work recognizing is a identity. And I believe that that is one of the rewards that, that whoever does an architect can receive. But also, I would like to make this statement in saying that in this discussed issue of how to act in cities, be able to find out that you are serving something that is above you and that has its own values that you are pleased to recognize as a professional, seems to me as an alternative, or seems I would like to say that is the way I would like to be seen my world. And I consider, as I said, the greatest gift that one can receive to be attached and then to be connected with the city, and even more with this city is the city where you used to live. And then I finish. Thank you very much.